Dear friends, welcome to this edition of VBS Anatoma, a series of gross anatomy videos. Today's video is on midline structures of the neck. I am Dr. Balasubramanian, Professor, Department of Anatomy here at St. John's Medical College, Bangalore, India. Now, this dissection called the midline structures of the neck enlists a series of structures from the region of the lower border of the mandible to the inlet to the thorax. You see, these are the two limitations, that is the upper boundary and the lower boundary. And in this, we are going to identify, as shown by this yellow dashed line, the structures that are there exactly in the midline. This is an interesting and an important dissection, commonly asked in the practical window dissections, sometimes in viva also. The point is, there are a number of structures, and individually as well as in clusters, these group of structures have very interesting anatomical relations of clinical importance. Hence, this is an important dissection area. You see, let's go through the details step by step from above downwards. That's the lower border of the mandible, clavicle at the lower end, manubrium in between the two clavicles. The upper border of the manubrium is there between the two mandibles. That gap between the two clavicles, where the manubrium doesn't fully jut out upwards, that's the sternal notch. Next, of course, important bony landmark, muscular landmark, is the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Now, we will take a dissection specimen from here onwards. Let's get the orientation right. What we have done is, we have done a very superficial dissection. All that I have done is reflected the skin. You can see the skin flaps. Then removed the combined platysma and the deep cervical fascia of this region. And that's it. Cleaned up a few muscles here and there, and then overall, I have cleaned up the specimen, that's all. Now let's try to go through an identification spree. That's the symphysis menti, that is the point where the two halves of the mandible are joined in the midline. Next, from there, extending down is a midline raphe, where the fibers of the mylohyoid muscle of the two sides cross. Now that's an important point to note, because lower end, it ends at the hyoid bone. That's the hyoid bone. Hyoid bone in this dissection is not so clearly visible because it's covered by muscles and fascia. I will try to show you a slightly better version of this in the next few slides. Now that's the muscle, mylohyoid, one from each side. They both come to the midline, and there's a small intercross of fibers, and that's the mylohyoid raphe. The mylohyoid muscle per se takes origin from the mylohyoid line on the inner aspect of the body of the mandible. Now, the same structures what we saw in the previous photograph, I have just enlarged the photograph, and let's repeat it because slight improvement in contrast is there. Let's try to recollect the points. Symphysis menti. The flashing dotted line is the raphe, which I mentioned earlier. Lower down, hyoid bone. That's the mylohyoid raphe, the flashing dash line, and the mylohyoid muscle. So we have just repeated what we saw in the previous slide. Next, basically, we are looking at structures between two bony borders. One is the symphysis menti and the adjacent lower border of the mandible. And in this region of the discussion, we are at the body and the greater corner of the hyoid bone. You see, I have given a digital version of the hyoid bone, placed it at that location to get you a proper orientation. You can see in the middle is the body, and extending on either sides, right and left, is the cornu, greater cornu of the hyoid bone. That gives you the location so that you will understand how the myelohyoid raphe ends lower down in the hyoid bone. Next, below that, below the hyoid bone, the next prominent structure we see is the laryngeal prominence or the thyroid prominence. Now that we have discussed in an earlier discussion, larynx, where it's much more prominent in males than in females. That apart, that brings us to the next level of the discussion. You see, that's the laryngeal prominence, that V-shaped notch. Little description of that. Now, basically, this is a prominence, a part of the thyroid cartilage. The upper border of the thyroid cartilage in the sagittal plane dips down to form this prominence. So therefore, it's a, in other words, we have already reached the thyroid cartilage. In fact, down the prominence, the two plates of the thyroid cartilage, right and left, fuse to form the angle of the thyroid cartilage. That's also quite prominent. Next, between the hyoid bone, you see, I have kept the hyoid bone back in location. Now, these are the two structures I want you to concentrate. You can see the flashing hyoid bone and the laryngeal prominence. Now, between the two, there is a membrane. That membrane is called the thyrohyoid membrane. Secondly, in the midline, both the membranes are fused and slightly thickened, and we call that central part of this conjoint membrane as the thyrohyoid ligament. Now you see, central part is called the median thyrohyoid ligament. Now let's take a look at some specimens for, you know, general museum exhibits to understand the concept better. See, the thyroid cartilage that I'm showing in the dissection and the same cartilage shown in a model. This model gives you a better orientation, then you will understand the dissection better. So that's the thyroid cartilage. Let's examine this model a little more in detail. We'll get the essence of that discussion explained. You see, that's the thyrohyoid membrane connecting the hyoid bone and the thyroid cartilage. Now, that blue structure is the one half of the thyroid cartilage. That's the median thyrohyoid. That is, the two thyrohyoid membranes in the midline is the median thyrohyoid ligament. Of course, the hyoid bone, greater cornu of the hyoid bone, that is the extension of the body. Then the laryngeal prominence, we have already seen, yet worthy of reinforcement here. Next, that's the body of the hyoid bone. You see, keeping this in orientation, we will go down to the next level below the thyroid cartilage. Obviously, the next structure below the thyroid is the cricoid cartilage, but between the lower border of the thyroid cartilage and the upper border of the cricoid cartilage is another membrane, namely the cricothyroid membrane. Certainly, in the midline, this same membrane is thickened to form the ligament, cricothyroid ligament. That's why I said cricothyroid membrane bar ligament. It's obvious that the central part is the ligament. Next, that's the cricoid cartilage. You see, thyroid above, the butterfly shaped thyroid cartilage above, ring shaped cricoid below, and between is the membrane, cricothyroid membrane. Next, a short break. Students who find this set of videos useful can subscribe to this channel, VBS Anatoma. If you opt for the bell button, you will also get time to time notifications of new videos on the channel. Now, this is another dissected specimen corresponding to the model, where we will try to identify maybe one or two additional points. That's the thyroid cartilage. That muscle running between the cricoid and the thyroid, you see, from the cricoid cartilage to the lower border of the thyroid cartilage is the cricothyroid muscle. That's a very important additional point. You can, although not in the midline, it is certainly in the vicinity of the dissection. Therefore, we will add this to the list. Next, the thyroid notch. We have discussed this, but good for reinforcement. And the laryngeal prominence. The prominent part of the notch is the laryngeal prominence. Next, we have finished, right? Well, let's take a quick recap. Symphysis menti, myelohyoid raphe or the central line, hyoid bone, thyrohyoid membrane and ligament, thyroid cartilage, then thyrohyoid membrane, then cricoid cartilage, and now below the cricoid cartilage we now reach the isthmus of the thyroid gland, that is the isthmus of the thyroid gland. But then I have taken one more specimen to bring home another interesting point. Sometimes the isthmus of the thyroid gland can have a extension upwards. You can see that extension is basically a ligamentous remnant, a fibrous remnant. That's called the levator glandulae thyroidea. Often a small projection of glandular tissue will precede the continuation of the ligament. That glandular tissue right from the upper border of the isthmus is the pyramidal lobe. It is very well seen in this particular specimen. In fact, the glandular portion is there quite a bit into the levator glandulae thyroidea also. That's quite an interesting add-on feature you can keep in mind. Next, let's continue a few more points on this model. You see that the muscle we actually saw in the dissection is being repeated in the model, cricothyroid muscle between the cricoid and the thyroid cartilage. Now, that's the cricoid cartilage. That's the isthmus of the thyroid gland. This side, there are tracheal rings. Note that the isthmus is not directly below the cricoid. There is a small gap. It's not well shown in this model. Nevertheless, in the dissections, you will see that the upper border of the isthmus is roughly below the second tracheal ring. That means there are tracheal ring number 1 and tracheal ring number 2 before the isthmus begins. In other words, the isthmus overlies the 3rd, 4th and the 5th tracheal rings, sometimes the 2nd, but we will, for today's discussion, we will treat it as 3rd, 4th and the 5th tracheal rings. That means there is a small gap between the upper border of the isthmus and the cricoid cartilage. Now that area has 2 tracheal rings. That means large enough to be clinically important. Therefore, 6th tracheal ring and below, 7th, 8th and others are below the lower border of the isthmus. Now, you see, trying to show the same in the specimen, just above the upper border of the isthmus of the thyroid gland and below the lower border of the cricoid cartilage, 1st and the 2nd tracheal rings. Likewise, 6th tracheal ring and lower ones in that number are below the lower border of the isthmus. Now, another specimen. Let's try to get a recap. See, the idea of showing you 2 or 3 specimens is to see subtle variations, but in spite of the variations, the characteristic features and the structures are very, very well seen. You see, again, thyroid cartilage, cricothyroid muscle, left lobe of the thyroid gland. And to introduce another point, there are some strap muscles we need to keep in mind. The largest one or the longest one I would say is the sternohyoid muscle. Now these strap muscles are there in this region. You will have to slightly separate the strap muscles to see the midline structures clearly, although no single muscle crosses the midline. Now, this therefore brings us, because we are in the discussion on the trachea, we are discussing the tracheal rings and its relations to the isthmus of the thyroid gland. Please remember, right at the beginning of the dissection, I said all that I have done is reflected the skin, the platysma and the deep cervical fascia, the combined flap, I have reflected, nothing else. In other words, the trachea at its beginning is reasonably close to the surface. Therefore, the advantage is, in the event of a upper respiratory tract blockade, or there is some, let's say, a foreign body or an edema or some other blockade, for whatever reasons, it is going to cause a compromise on the airflow, and total obstruction can be very disastrous. To handle the situation as an emergency, it is therefore obvious that being such a superficial structure, by the word superficial, I mean in a relative context, because there is a deep fascia there, don't get confused. Point is, you can access the trachea with a minimum of surgery. Therefore, what we can do is, we can make a nick either through the isthmus of the thyroid gland, which is common, then push the two halves this side and that side. Of course, control the bleeding, because thyroid is a very highly bleeding, highly vascular gland. That's that apart. You can make a nick in the anterior wall of the trachea and enable breathing. Now that nick will make sure that the lumen is accessed and the patient will get oxygen. Better still, you can put a tracheostomy pipe in that and keep it for some more time, depending upon the clinical requirements. Now this procedure, where you make a nick in the anterior thoracic wall and place a tracheostomy pipe, this procedure is called as tracheostomy. Making a perforation into the trachea, followed by necessary support like placing a tube. This will give the patient immediate relief, and oxygen is now available. So the emergency has been sorted out. Subsequently, you can handle the rest of the clinical issues. You see, here is a patient with the tracheostomy tube in its location. It's been placed there and it's been fixed in a proper way. Now, you see the animation there. There are two rings, dashed circles. They will tell you those are the two locations where you can do a reasonably comfortable and safe tracheostomy. The upper one is through the isthmus. The second one is below the isthmus. I repeat, the one through the isthmus may risk bleeding, but that's not a major thing. We can handle the bleeding. And the second one is below the isthmus. Any one of these can be used for tracheostomy procedure. Now that's the importance of this area of the midline structure. Next, now we have finished everything, we have reached the trachea and the lowermost area we have come. We have already reached the upper border of the manubrium sternae, and that area right above it is the suprasternal space. There's nothing much as far as this discussion is concerned, except maybe the lowermost end of the anterior jugular vein and a transverse vein connecting the two. Maybe there may be a lymph node. Otherwise, it's a surgical space to note, because the deep fascia there splits into two to create this space. Now you see, this is another model which will give you a summarized tour of all the structures we have seen in the dissection. Let's start with symphysis menti, thyrohyoid ligament and the membrane. Of course, let's not forget the hyoid bone. Next, thyroid cartilage, then cricoid cartilage and the cricothyroid membrane and the cricothyroid ligament, you see, then the thyroid gland, then the tracheal rings. Remember, tracheal rings 1 and 2 are above the isthmus, 6 and below are below the isthmus of the thyroid gland. Of course, cricoid cartilage to complete the discussion. Now, this was an interesting panoramic tour. Next, I told you, although strictly speaking the midline structures we have enumerated, there are certain structures in the immediate vicinity which we shall not ignore. The muscle I have shown you earlier, the strap muscles, this muscle was shown to you in an earlier part of this video, sternohyoid. It's the longest of the strap muscles, running from the sternum up to the hyoid bone. But deep inside that, there are other muscles we will try to identify one by one. You see, running from the sternum up to the thyroid is the sternothyroid muscle. I have shown two, one on the right side and the corresponding one on the left side. That muscle is the sternothyroid. Now, this deep muscle is basically split into two, although it is running from the sternum as far high as the hyoid. It is interrupted by the oblique line of the thyroid cartilage to split into two muscles, sternothyroid and thyrohyoid muscle. Sternothyroid and thyrohyoid muscle. That means so far we have seen three muscles, sternohyoid, thyrohyoid and sternothyroid muscles. Now there is one last muscle at the edge of this dissection, that's the omohyoid muscle. That is the omohyoid muscle. It comes from the shoulder region, scapular region, and it joins this group of three muscles. Totally there are four strap muscles, four on each side. That's the omohyoid muscle. Next, to continue the clinical points, note that this midline structures that we saw, this dissection, particularly the upper half or 3/4 of this area, is interesting because it coincides with the line of development of the thyroid gland. You must have seen this in embryology. It's an endodermal derivative from the foramen cecum, goes down as a duct, then bifurcates into two, and then the acinar part develops. However, there is possibility that ectopic thyroid tissues may be seen isolated here and there. It's likely that we may see one in the tongue itself, intralingual, or it may be in the floor of the mouth, or it may be below the hyoid bone. If it is in the floor of the mouth, it is above the hyoid. Next is infrahyoid. These are some of the, the patient may present with a swelling without much other symptoms, or sometimes a little swallowing difficulty. So just keep in mind that there could be ectopic thyroids in this area of surgical anatomy. Now that was an overview of the midline structures of the neck. I hope you have benefited from this video. There are several other videos of gross anatomy and histology in this website. As required, you can choose to see these videos. Thank you so much.